Am I on?
Yep.
What was with the music? That was... Yeah, dramatic for sure. Hey, it's good to be here with all of you. Thank you so much for being here to worship here at Safe Harbor. Again, I'm Jeff. I'm one of the pastors here on staff, and I'm really excited to be here, and I only preach every few months or so, but every time I do, it's a real blessing, and it's an honor just to bring the word today. As Franklin said, we are going to be, I don't know if you mentioned this, we're going to be entering into a new series next week called The God Connection, and Franklin's going to be leading the small group, and we're going to be, if you've been here in the last few months, you probably have seen this before. This is the gospel wheel. And so the series we're going to be in is called The God Connection. We're going to hit all these spokes on the gospel wheel. And right in the middle of that is the gospel. And Dan asked me a few weeks ago if I'd be willing to preach today. And I asked him, what series are we going to be entering into? And just trying to think, what does Safe Harbor need to hear? And he told me we were going to be in this series. And I thought it would be good before we go into the gospel wheel to talk about what exactly is the gospel. Okay, so we're going to be talking about the gospel today, which I'm really excited about because if you've heard me preach a few months ago, I talked about the things that the church grabs onto and makes like the little bit of truth from that and makes it the whole truth. And I say, when we make the little bit of truth the whole truth, it becomes a half truth and it's not truth then. I don't know if you guys remember that, but the gospel is like the one thing that the church needs to hold on to and that we need to like grab on like and never loosen up. Like we need to keep this always to the forefront. Like the gospel is the thing that we as a church need to root and ground ourselves in. So I'm really excited about this series. I mean this 1 week series, the gospel, before we enter into this. So I'm going to pray, and we're going to dive in. So let's go to God. Father, thank you so much for just your people, just your family, for how you've gathered us here, and just for being a God who is alive, who's active, who's a God who isn't like in the business of just like having your way, but you're in the business of partnership, God. And you choose to partner with us. And so, God, thank you so much for the opportunity that we have to just hear your word this morning. God, I pray just for everyone here that the Holy Spirit would just illuminate our hearts and our minds and whatever things that we think about when we think of the gospel, that you would just get rid of, God, that you would transform our mental hard drives and reveal to us your definitions, God, what the gospel is according to the apostles, and how the church in the 21st century needs to align itself with that, God. So I just pray all of that in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Okay, so I want to ask you a question, and I invite you to think about it with me. But what is the gospel? Okay, what is the gospel? If someone would ask you, in 2 minutes or less, what is the gospel? And what are some ways that you heard the gospel preached? As you're thinking about that, when I was in Bible college, if any of you have taken a class on just the idea of the interpretation of Scripture. In the realm of interpretation, there's an idea called hermeneutics. Okay, let me hear you say hermeneutics. Okay, hermeneutics sounds, if you've never heard that word, you may be thinking, what in the world is hermeneutics? And that was my initial thought too. At Bible college, there's a class you had to take called Hermeneutics 101. And hermeneutics is this real fancy word that simply is just the idea of the interpretation of Scripture. Okay, hermeneutics is very important, and it's something that we as the church need to have a little bit of an understanding. Like, you don't need to be a Bible scholar to have an idea of hermeneutics, but hermeneutics is the art and the science of interpretation of anything. We do it all the time as 21st century Americans. When, if any of you here, I don't even know who reads newspapers anymore, but if you do, you know, good for you. But if you do, you automatically have a newspaper hermeneutic. Okay, when you're on Facebook and you're on your newsfeed, like you have a hermeneutic for that. Or like if you read a letter that your spouse wrote you, like you have a specific interpretation. Like, oh, this is from my wife. There's a specific occasion that she's writing this. What's her purpose? Like, it's just automatic things that we don't even think about. But when we approach the scriptures, hermeneutics is about putting ourselves in the mind of the original audience, okay? Hermeneutics is very important because it's easy for us to go to the scriptures with a 21st century filter that we look through, when actually this is an ancient text, okay? And the reason I'm driving this point is because it is important for us to realize that this book, in my hermeneutics class, my professor, you know, you should have seen all the people that got upset, but my professor said this one thing. He said, the scriptures were written for us as the people of God, but they weren't written to us. Okay, you should have seen all the hands that like shot up in the class, like, what do you mean this isn't written to us? We're Christians, and like, this is God's word for it. And my professor called me and was like, no, like, this is written to a different audience, at various audiences through millennia, different authors, different audiences, and it's important at the bare minimum for you and I as a church today to realize that. And because as we approach the scripture, we need to realize that the scriptures weren't written to us. Like, we don't think like the way that the audience does. And so the more we can better understand that, the better you and I can remove that 21st century filter. Okay, because we bring stuff to the text. Are you guys driving me? Sorry, this might be a little dry, hopefully not. But the reason I'm driving this is because when we ask the question, what is the gospel? We need to ask, what filter, when we as 21st century Americans, are we looking through and go into the text and be like, oh yeah, that's the gospel? When no, actually, we need to do the best we can, remove what culture tells us is the gospel and other factors, and just go to the text the best we can with a dry, just openness to what the text says. So, what is the gospel? Okay, what is the gospel? What do you think of when you think of the gospel? Take your Bibles, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Okay, 1 Corinthians 15. Okay, this is one of the places where, one of the few places in the New Testament where Paul just kind of lays it out. What is the gospel? Okay, and he's writing to this church in Corinth in the first century under the Roman Empire, and he's about to remind them about the gospel that he preached. Okay, and I would encourage you, follow me in your text. And, you know, today I thought about it and I decided, you know, I have a word for you today. So I invite you, if you didn't bring a journal, you know, go ahead, pull out your phone, have a hard copy, or you could use your phone for the text, I don't care. But like, have a note, and I encourage you just like, follow along with me. I don't know why that came up. Okay. It's all right. I got it. Don't worry, guys. I got it. Okay. We're used to the other guys. Yeah, I don't want them to know the secrets up ahead, so. All right, 1 Corinthians 15, verse 1. This is Paul. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and which you stand, and by which you are being saved if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. Okay, stop there. Paul is saying, he's reminding these believers of the gospel that he one day preached to them. And he said, this is the gospel on which you've taken your stand, you've rooted yourself in, this is the gospel that you are presently being saved, which is a weird concept as we, like, what do you mean you're being saved? Like, it's a very Pauline way of saying it. In verse 3, he says, for I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received. So Paul is saying, this is the gospel that I received from the apostles. And if you read Paul in his other letters, you see that Paul, a lot of times customizes the gospel. And in Galatians, he declares the gospel that Jesus himself gave to him in Galatians 1, where Jesus revealed himself to him. But here, he's saying, this is the gospel I received from the apostles. This is the apostolic gospel tradition. It's the gospel that the apostles preach and that the churches preach and that churches all down throughout history preach until the gospel that was recorded for us today. This is what he received, and this is what he's passing on to them. For I deliver to you as of first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, that he appeared to Cephas and then to the 12. So, what is the gospel? Paul explicitly says it. Jesus, by implication, he lived, he died, he was buried, he resurrected, and he appeared in accordance with the scriptures. He doesn't say anything about you and I. I mean, he says that Jesus died for sin, but he doesn't say anything about, it's just really interesting, he doesn't say anything about heaven, he doesn't say anything about hell, he doesn't say anything about your personal salvation, like exhorting the Corinthians, believe in your personal, no, he just says that Jesus lived, he died, he was buried, he resurrected, and he appeared in accordance with the scriptures. I don't know if I've ever heard a gospel presentation that way. It's really, really interesting. So I would exhort to you that the gospel is the story of Jesus. Okay? The gospel is the story of Jesus. A few thoughts from this. By the Christ of Paul's gospel, okay? The Greek word Christ is the same word for the Hebrew word Messiah. Okay, the Hebrew word Messiah is a kingly term. It's son of God. It's ruler. Okay, so this Christ is the promised Messiah. It's the Messiah of Israel. It's the promised ruler of the whole world. It's the son of God from Psalm 2. Okay, Christ, and then it says that Christ died, he was buried, he resurrected, he appeared. It's a very narrative format, all in accordance with the scriptures. A few months ago, my last sermon, when I talked about the story of Jesus and how the story of Jesus didn't come out of nowhere, you know, the story of Jesus has a backstory, which is this long narrative of the Hebrew scriptures, okay? It's this long narrative of what God has been doing since the beginning of time, okay? He says that Jesus died and he rose in accordance with the scriptures. You and I, we want to go to this and we want to be like, pull out all the individual messianic promises. Like, we want to jump right to Isaiah 53. But Paul, that's just the tip of the iceberg. What Paul is saying is that the whole narrative of Scripture, like, that is what Jesus died and rose in accordance with. It's not one or two proof texts. It's this whole narrative. And so, like I said in my last sermon, it's important for us to realize that we need to understand the story. We need to understand the story of Scripture. This is a beautiful text, 2 Corinthians, and we sing this song a lot of times. As surely as God is faithful, our word to you has not been yes and no, for the Son of God, Jesus Christ, whom we proclaimed among you, Silvanus and Timothy and I, was not yes and no, but in him is always yes. For all the promises of God find their yes in Jesus. So the gospel it's important to read this in its first century context. Like, he's talking about the story that the people in the first century have in the back of their mind of what God's been doing since the beginning of time. We need to understand the story. And I don't know any better way to simplify the Old Testament than to just look at the covenants. Okay, the covenants. The promises of God that he made to Abraham, to Moses, to Israel, to David. Those are the promises. It has a very Israel-like idea, is that God made these promises that by implication God is going to impart to the whole world. Like, God says to Abraham, I will bless you, I will make your family a blessing so that the whole world will be blessed. Okay? And those are the promises that God is fulfilling. Like, Jesus is the fulfillment of this long story. This might be a little weird, and that's why I told you guys take notes, because I want you guys to wrestle through this. I'm not trying to necessarily convince you today. This is probably kind of weird. The gospel is the story of Jesus. Okay, like the Gospels themselves, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. That's very, you don't see anywhere in there the writer saying, believe in Jesus so that you can go to heaven one day. The Gospels are the Gospel because they are telling the story of Jesus, his life, his death, his burial, resurrection, ascension. So this is going to be a weird distinction, but the Gospel is not personal salvation. Okay, the Gospel is not personal salvation. Okay, the Gospel is the story of Jesus. Okay, most contemporary gospel presentations make our final destination the focus. Okay, actually go back. They make the final destination the focus. Okay, in eighth grade, there was this leader from my youth group. His name actually was Bob. I'm not making it up. It sounds like I'd make it up. But his name was Bob, and Bob asked me to go to this church one day that was putting on this play. And I don't know if it's still going on. Maybe you've seen it, but it's called, I think it was Heaven's Gates or Hell's Flames. And then I think like the subtitle was like, Where Are You Going to Be When Reality Strikes? Okay, and so I was in eighth grade, and I went with Bob, and we went, and I remember one scene in particular where there was this family, okay? This family was driving, mom and a dad, brother and sister, they're driving, and they're having a conversation, and they look like normal people, good people. Like, they seem like they were average good people. And the lights shut off as they're driving. You hear these tire noises, and then the lights come back on, and the backdrop of the whole stage is like, angels, and there's this big staircase with a golden door, and the family wakes up and they're talking like, what happened? Like, and then they realize like, oh, we're in heaven right now. How, we're in heaven. This is, I've heard about this. We're in heaven. And then Jesus appears. He walks through the door and walks down the stairs, and everyone's getting excited like, oh, Jesus, you're here. This is so awesome. We're in heaven. And then Jesus comes over, and he comes over to the boy, and he was probably like 8 or 9, and Jesus puts his arm around him, and Jesus says, I don't remember his name, but Jesus walks this boy up the stairs, and, you know, for whatever reason, the people aren't like following Jesus up there. They're just like, Jesus, no, like, take us with you. And then the lights shut off again, and when the lights shut off, like, the backdrop changed, and it was all like red and like fiery. And then you hear like this crazy guitar solo. And then next thing you know, this guy dressed in all black with a cape and a ski mask jumps out, and he's Satan apparently. And he starts laughing and walking on stage like this, like he's like Gollum or something. And he comes and he sends out his 3 henchmen, like that are demons supposedly. And he says, "Grab them!" And the demons grab them, and they like, they're dragging them, and Satan says, throw them in the pits of hell. And so then it was great theatrical stunts, honestly. The demons grab them, and they're running, and they throw, and they dove, like, off stage. It was crazy. But I'll tell you what, as an eighth grader, I was scared out of my mind. I was like, oh my gosh, I do not want to die and experience whatever that just was. Like, that was honestly, that was horrifying. And I'm a very OCD kind of person, and I'm also, I can be very paranoid. Like, you could talk to my wife. I can be a very paranoid person and overthink things. And as a middle schooler, I did not need to see that, because that was stuck in my mind for, even to this day, I'm just like, what in the world? And then last night when I was actually practicing, I Googled it. You could watch the full, different churches have done it and thrown it in. And it is freaky. But so here's the thing. That is a method of persuasion. Okay, that's what I would label that. That is a method of persuasion. And I think it is a method. I think that it is a legitimate method. And do I believe that God uses that stuff? Absolutely. I think that God uses that. The thing I want to say, though, is that is that the gospel? Is that the gospel? Or is that just a method? Okay. A dominant mode of persuading people to believe the gospel in the last 100 years has been something called the Romans Road of Salvation. And actually, stay in 1 Corinthians, keep your finger there, but turn to Romans chapter 1, okay? And as you're turning to Romans 1, I'm going to walk you through the Romans Road real quick, okay? The Romans Road to Salvation, okay? So here's the typical, and it all stems from the Romans Road, I think, which is a legitimate method of persuasion. But the Romans Road starts in Romans 3. Go to Romans 1, though. Romans 3, and it says that no one is righteous, no one understands God, no one seeks God. So here's the predicament of humans. The gospel starts with humans and how you're lost and how you're doomed to go to a bad place. And then you jump to Romans 6, and it says that for the wages of sin is death. Okay, so here's the thing. We're all sinners, right? And you're all destined to spend an eternity apart from hell and be with Satan and his henchmen. And who here doesn't want to go to the hell? You know, all of us? Okay, well, the good news is that the free gift of God is eternal life. Okay, so you don't have to go to hell. Okay, and then it ends in Romans 10. And it says that in verse 9. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Okay, so there you go. Just believe in your heart, confess with your mouth, and you don't have to go to hell one day. You can spend eternity in bliss, and you can walk up those stairs, and you don't have to be with, in hell and in the flames, and it's going to be bliss. It's going to be great. Okay, you don't have to go to hell. Okay, again, this is a method. Okay, and I think it's a legitimate method, but my question is that the gospel? And for anyone who just starts with our stories, I want to say, let's go, or start in, with that method, I would encourage everyone to start at the very beginning of Romans. So Romans 1, verse 1, Paul lays it out sort of again. Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God. Okay, so stop there. Paul, an apostle, which he's a messenger, an envoy, someone who's declaring a message, which is why he's set apart for the good news of God. Verse 2, which God promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures. So there's this Hebrew scripture idea again concerning his son, who was descended from David according to the flesh and was declared to be the Son of God in power according to the resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship to bring about the obedience of faith for the sake of his name among all the nations. And it is this gospel, which jumped down to verse 16, that Paul says, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, the good news. It is the power of God for salvation to everyone who believes. That preposition is a major distinction. For salvation. Paul doesn't say that the gospel is salvation. Okay, if you believe the gospel, are you saved? Absolutely. But the distinction, which may be kind of weird, and I get it because this is just what we've been just taught from the very beginning, that the gospel is salvation. But I want to make a distinction that the gospel is Jesus. And because Jesus is fulfilling this story, it is a saving story. But it's not believing that the story will save you that saves you. It's believing in Jesus. Okay? So turn back to 1 Corinthians 15. 1 Corinthians 15. If anyone's still with me, unless I've just completely blew your mind and you're just like, what in the world are you talking about? I get it. So we've made the story of Jesus a story that simply is about his death. That because Jesus died, now we don't have to die, and now we can live eternity with God. But here's the thing. We need to emphasize the resurrection. Okay, 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says very little about, he doesn't say anything about heaven. He doesn't say anything about hell, but he starts off by saying that the gospel is Jesus lived, he died, he was buried, resurrected, he ascended, and that he appeared. Okay, and then he spends the rest of chapter 15 explaining, because Jesus was resurrected, what are the implications? Okay, he spends the rest of 1 Corinthians 15 talking about the implications. And this is very important because you and I, as the American church, we've emphasized the death and we've completely lost the resurrection, that it doesn't even matter that Jesus was raised. Okay, it was in verse 17 of chapter 15 that Paul says, "And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile and you are still in your sins." Okay, without the resurrection proves that Jesus' death has that saving power. And a lot of scholars believe that Paul lays out the gospel in the first five verses, but then he continues it in verses 20 to 28. So that's what we're going to look at, is that because Jesus has raised, this is the implication, verse 20. So if you're in your Bibles, look at verse 20 with me. But in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. Christ the firstfruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, after destroying every rule, every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all his enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. For God has put all things in subjection under his feet. For when it says, all things are put in subjection, it is plain that he is accepted who put all things in subjection under him. When all things are subjected to him, then the Son himself will also be subjected to him who puts all things in subjection under him, that God may be all in all. Okay, that is a mouthful. But what Paul is saying is that, like, because Jesus has resurrected, now he has, oh yeah, this picture. We don't have to go there. We could talk about that later. The gospel proclaims that Jesus resurrected as the world's rightful ruler. Okay, that is what the gospel proclaims. And how often do we hear that? Is that Jesus is the king, he's ruling, and that is the good news. Like, God's promises from the Old Testament is that God is going to come back and he's going to become king. He's gonna come back and he's gonna take back what belongs to him. But the thing is, it happened in a way that no one expected. It happened through a bloody death, and Jesus rose from the grave. And because he resurrected, according to what Paul's saying, verse 20, 28, is now all things has now been subjected to Jesus. Like, his rule means that all things belong to him. That's Romans 1. That in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says the gospel is a narrative of the life of Jesus. Okay, in Romans 1, he takes it a different approach and says that the gospel is the declaration that Jesus, who was the son of King David, who now because of the resurrection is declared to be the Son of God in power, who now claims the loyalty and allegiance of the whole world. So if you're taking notes, write down Romans 1, and I encourage you to look at that yourself this week. Romans 1, 1 Corinthians 15, it's about Jesus. And verses 20 to 28 of 1 Corinthians 15 is saying that Jesus is the king of the whole world. And Jesus doesn't simply care about saving souls, but he cares about redeeming all things. Thank you. All things, not just souls. He cares about us and where we're going to spend eternity. But the distinction I'm making is what is the gospel? Okay, is it the message that you can be saved? Or is it the message that Jesus is ruling, that he is the king of the whole world, that through his death and resurrection, that Jesus is redeeming all things? Okay, and if this is all weird to you, I would just say, and going back to the Romans road, like I said, those are methods of persuasion. Those are illegitimate methods. But the distinction I'm making is they're legitimate, but is there any evidence in the New Testament that the apostles or Jesus evangelized by waking people up to the prospect of hell when they die? That is the question that we need to ask as people who are trying to interpret the text. Personally, I don't see it. I don't see Jesus ever evangelizing that way. And that's not to say that they're not legitimate methods, but we need to ask the question, how did the apostles preach the gospel in Acts? And how did Jesus preach the gospel in the gospels, if you even think that Jesus preached the gospel? So those are the questions I'm driving at. Okay, because Jesus is reigning as the king of the whole world, that means the gospel and it is cosmic in its scope. Jesus cares about redeeming all things. Like, this is his world, and he wants to redeem all things. Okay, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away, behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Okay, one of the greatest caricatures of the cross in our gospel presentations today is the fact that we pin the Father up against the Son. And we say that God, so John 3:16, we say that God so hated the world that he decided to kill his Son. But that's not what John says. John says God so loved the world that he gave his only Son. It says that God, it wasn't that God was mad at, like, so mad at he had the, like, it was God in Christ. God in Christ. Like, it wasn't like the Father and the Son were completely separated. No, the plan of redemption was God and the Son, the Father and the Son working together. Like, God in Christ reconciled the whole world to himself. Okay, Colossians, for in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether on earth or in heaven, making peace by the blood of his cross. All things in heaven and on earth is the scope of redemption. This has major implications. This has uber implications. I listened to a podcast this week by a guy named Sky Gitani. Really good. It was on a theology of vocation. Okay, because our gospel presentations, we've limited to happy people in a happy place after they die. Because we made the gospel that, we've lost, like, this idea that God wants to redeem all things. Okay, and he in this podcast, he was talking about, we need to, as a church, we need to come back to a good theology of vocation. Okay, this idea that your calling, first and foremost, is union with Christ. That is your individual calling. You are called to deep fellowship and union with Jesus. That is your calling. And as Americans today, we are blessed, like, we can choose what we want to do. But we made so much about what is our calling. What is our calling? What is God calling me to? But our calling is primarily that. And some of you may be married, and you're like, yeah, I loved my spouse when we got married. But, you know, he changed. You know, I didn't marry that person. I would exhort to you that actually your calling now is to love that person. That is what God's calling you to. Vocationally, we've, as a church, we've made of calling, we've lifted up being a pastor and preaching and being a missionary as the primary callings. That's what ultimately matters, because God cares about redeeming souls, right? That's what those, like, why, if that's true, shouldn't we all be missionaries and preachers? That's all that God cares about, is redeeming souls, right? No, like, yeah, God cares about redeeming souls through preaching the gospel. But God also cares about redeeming art, redeeming business, redeeming good management, leadership. Like, God cares about redeeming all things. And a side note about calling is, we look at the scriptures, and a lot of the prophets who got called to do their ministry, like, think about Moses. He didn't want to go back to Egypt. We've made calling such a weird thing, where, like, calling is like, how can I feel good about what I'm doing? You know what I mean? Like, it is about, but, like, we need to remember, like, God, like, number one, God calls you to be in union with him. Number two, God calls you, like, God, you know what you're called to do today, and it may be something you don't want to do, but you know what you're called to do. All this to say is that God cares about redeeming all things. By implication to the gospel, we are called to make more than a simple decision. Okay, our gospel presentations today is about getting people to sign on the dotted line. It is about getting people to make a decision. And the church is confused with why isn't our church filled with people? Well, where is everyone? You know, all these people that made a declaration of faith, aren't they saved? Why aren't they in church? Why aren't they making disciples? I would suggest that it could possibly be our way of preaching the gospel, where it's about fire insurance. It's about getting people to sign on the dotted line. It's about giving people an emotional experience to be like, yeah, I don't want to go to hell one day. When, yeah, I personally, yes, I affirm the wrath of God. I affirm that there is a hell that we should talk about. But is that the way that Jesus and the apostles preach? I don't think so. And so the gospel is not a call to make a decision, but it's an invitation to discipleship. And that's a major distinction, where this is not about saved and unsaved anymore. This is about you and your union with Christ. This is about a daily decision to walk with God. It's about a daily decision. Okay, discipleship is about walking with Jesus. Discipleship is about walking with Jesus. Essentially, because discipleship is such a churchy term, I've heard people use the word apprenticeship. I think that's a really good word. Think about it vocationally. Like, you're someone's apprentice. You're learning to do what they do. And that's not something that Jesus just did in his context, in his first century with his disciples. But this is something you and I are called to today. And I don't have much of a programmatic way of, like, doing this other than, like, the church is called to these things: Bible reading, prayer, silence, solitude, sacraments, Sabbath, church gatherings, community, generosity. Like, that's what we're called to. And so, you know, as we go into, like, the gospel wheel, and we start talking about how does this play out in small groups, and I'm thinking about us in our own church context, like, how does this play out for you and I? Let me talk to all the small group leaders. If you're a small group leader, listen up. If you're a small group leader, how are you incorporating those things in small group? This sounds weird, but we live in a busy world. This is one of my big pet peeves. We need more silence and solitude. Okay? We need to create spaces where people can actually experience the presence of God. That it is through that people connect with God. It is opening yourself up to the grace of God. Okay, how are we doing that in our small groups? Okay, how are we teaching people to read the Bible in a way that's Jesus-centric? Like, maybe you're looking at me and you're like, Jeff, I don't know how to preach the gospel. It's much easier to try to get people to make a decision and scare people out of a place and try to convince them to the beauty of heaven. We need to read the gospels. Number one, we need to read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. The best way to evangelize is just tell people about Jesus. Okay, just tell people about Jesus. And yeah, sure, we can mention Jesus when we use these methods, but I'm talking about a gospel that is Jesus-centric, Jesus-soaked, where it is in your face, the beauty of Christ. This is what I talked about in my last sermon. The beauty and supremacy of Christ is the point. And so if you're asking me, how do you preach the gospel? Just tell people about Jesus. But if you're not reading the gospels and you don't know Jesus yourself, how are you going to do that? We need to have a better understanding of who the person of Jesus was, his mission, what he said, what he accomplished, and how that fulfilled the Old Testament. Like, there's so many different angles. And it's not our job to make decisions, but it's our job to be like, wow, Jesus has been so good. And to tell people about our relationship with Jesus. And that is not like a heavy weight. It is not our job to make decisions for people or try to scare people. Yeah. Discipleship is about walking with Jesus. It's not about and our methods have made discipleship kind of non-existent. Where people have made a decision, so they're good, and now why aren't people following Jesus? We need to be doing this ourselves. Which isn't like a heavy burden. Like, Jesus invites us to walk with him. Okay, as I close, I'm just going to read this story real quick. This is, I think Dan preached on this the other week. At that time, Jesus declared, "I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that you have hidden these things from the wise and understanding and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. So maybe this sermon is like, man, Jeff, I think I get what you're saying, but it's still confusing. This isn't supposed to be a heavy burden. This is an invitation today for us as the church to realign ourselves with what the apostles have said the gospel is, with what Jesus said the gospel is, and to open ourselves up, to rework our own hermeneutic, to be like, okay, what has culture taught me that the gospel is, and what is it that the scriptures say? I'm not trying to convince anyone here today, and I'd love to talk to anyone who has questions, but like, I'm just exhorting us today, like, let's go back to the scriptures. Let's read what the apostles say. Let's see that no matter what methods we use, which are all fine, that the gospel is the story of Jesus, who he was, what he accomplished, what he's doing right now, and how he invites each and every one of us into discipleship, walking with Jesus. Like that is it. Like Jesus, and so as we go into the gospel wheel the next few weeks or whatever, like let's remember the gospel. Let's not make the gospel something that it's not. Let me pray. Father, thank you so much for just your scriptures and how they challenge us, how they may confront ways that we think and ways that we've made ourselves comfortable. But God, we invite you, make us uncomfortable. Rework the way that we've thought about things. Invite us into a deeper and truer way of being your people, God. Jesus, thank you so much for who you are. And we repent of ways that we've put other things before you and we've said, that's the good news. But no, Jesus, you are the good news. Like, you are the gospel. And we align with you. Thank you, Jesus. Pray all this in your name. Amen.